experts who are telling me about as many cases of IP infringement in the United States as I've heard of within UTC companies in China. He said, their view is, we want to give the patent office as much detail as possible about our products, so that later there's no equivocation about what is our IP property and what someone else has done. The Chinese are aware of it. Now, do we expect them to accept less information about our product than we would give our own patent office in the United States? They feel that's unreasonable.
I think we fear that it's not as secure. I guess that's the big issue there, that the information that we share with the Chinese is not as secure as perhaps the information we share with the
U.S. I can see that. Yeah.
Question here.
Actually, two questions, but I'm also related. My name is Walter Anderson from USF right now. You had touched, Trevor, on the energy costs in the economy. And if you take a look at China's policy and how it's going to adapt to that, are they going to go nuclear? Or what are their attitudes towards energy in the future? How are they going to meet their needs? Second question is, if you take a look back at the 50s and 60s, the economic models for Japan and Germany in particular, their economic growth patterns looked out of the world by the year 2000. One thing that I think people did not include at that time was the cost of labor. And the cost of labor, if you take your model the way it is right now and project it out to 2030, how high does that go? The reason I put the two together is because if these two factors change, as they inevitably will, how does that change the equation for trade in the future? Because it's not just the United States that's trying to open up the Chinese trade market. It is all of the other European countries, the developed countries, but I think most importantly as well, the consumers in China, from everything that I know, they also want to open it up as well. That's an incredibly powerful force that overtakes any kind of strategic dialogue or long-term management of the current equation. I'd rather change the equation than manage the current.
Let me, the first question is a big one, and I'd be happy to follow up with you after in greater detail. Let me just make a kind of narrow comment on the nuclear side. The target is to expand nuclear capacity from 8 gigawatts today to 40 gigawatts in 2020. If they reach that goal, which is possible, it'll be a third of the global build in nuclear capacity over the next 15 years. So if you're a nuclear equipment provider, China's an important market. In terms of nuclear power as a solution for China's energy needs, even if they get to 40 gigawatts, that'll only account for 3% of total installed capacity in the country in 2020. So it barely makes a dent. So the majority will be pulverized coal for the use of that. I guess the second question about labor costs and how they will impact growth. And the question is whether or not productivity can keep pace as fast as the growth in labor costs, which today it has. This is where the rebalancing question comes into play. If you look at the models going out, if they continue investment at the rate that it currently is, at 40% of GDP, 45% of GDP, then productivity is going to decline significantly. So rebalancing towards services and consumption will make that growth model more sustainable.
Yes, ma'am.
The question I have to ask is, are we overreacting to China, a country which is still a dictatorship, and a far less than collaborative partner, when in fact maybe we should be looking to India to help us resolve some of our issues. And it is a democratic country, and it is a collaborative trade partner.
Bill?
We are working with both countries, so I don't think it's any lower than
that. Bill?
I've visited India many times, and I've lived in Hong Kong, right on the border of China, so I have quite a good experience working with both. Whereas India is a democracy, it is very, very deeply ingrained socialist. And whereas China is a communist country, they are some of the greatest entrepreneurs in the world. I mean, this is a huge contradiction. India will never be China. Maybe they will do well in some of the professional trades, engineering, and so forth, but as far as entrepreneurship and as far as what China's doing, I don't see India ever getting there. I mean, they just will endlessly debate something totally ridiculous. Never make any decisions.
But where is the clash point, and is there an inevitable clash point between the entrepreneurship that you talk about and Communist Party control? I mean, is this out in the future someplace, or is it now? Is there going to be a clash at some point where China simply has to make a decision, as the Soviet Union, 2 years ago, what happened there, the political system was toppled. I don't think China is ready for that. Bill, what do you think about that?
$64 question.
Well, inflation is probably a few more
problems. It's an excellent question, and I know the so-called, I don't get a laugh out of China experts, which, you know, we all just scratch the surface. But they're the jury's out, and I think looking from past experiences about smaller countries where we have gone through this type of dictatorship, that type of government, and the economy blossoming, and the standard of living improved to a point where the government realized, hey, and this was with our Chinese friends in Taiwan. I know there are a lot of differences between mainland and Taiwan, but in that case, that was the result. Now, again, I know there are a lot of people that are hoping that that will be the case. And one of your colleagues, Jim Mann, who has been writing a lot about what he thinks that is not the case, and he's not as optimistic. So, you know, I hate to equivocate so much, but it really is.
But you did well.